News alert. You check your phone and see a notification announcing a new study that shows that eating an apple a day keeps the doctor away. But when you open the link, you discover that the crop trial, a large trial examining the effect of daily consumption of fruit of all kinds on the number of primary care visits, actually showed that consuming fruit regularly had no impact on the number of primary care visits. That headline was based on a subgroup analysis, specifically for apple consumption. So should you believe the results of this subgroup analysis, toss out the other fruit that you love, and eat only apples? What are some of the key issues we need to think through when it comes to making clinical decisions based on subgroup analyses? Well-designed, randomized, controlled trials can generate reliable data to answer clinical questions, but they're time-intensive and often come with hefty price tags. To learn as much as possible about who might benefit from a treatment, investigators often examine treatment effects in different subsets of trial participants. Perhaps a given treatment has a different effect based on the age of the participant, or their baseline blood pressure, or even the type of fruit consumed daily. But these subgroup analyses should be approached with caution. Let's talk about a few specific reasons why. First, selecting a smaller sample from a larger group diminishes the effect of randomization. Confounding factors that were previously balanced may be reintroduced. Imagine that the participants who ate apples, as compared to other fruit, were more likely to work as teachers. They might then be younger, with fewer chronic health conditions, and therefore might have fewer primary care visits than others in the trial. Second, subgroup analyses require us to reconsider statistical significance. The more subgroup analyses performed, the more statistical testing involved, which increases the likelihood of getting a positive result from chance alone. A subgroup analysis may therefore detect an association between apple eaters and number of primary care visits, when in fact no association exists. Third, we have to think about statistical power, which is the probability of finding an effect if there is one to be found. For example, daily orange consumption is known to increase vitamin C levels. If the difference in vitamin C levels between orange eaters and non-orange eaters is large, this effect can be detected even with a small sample size. But if the effect is small, there could be too few participants to meaningfully detect the difference in vitamin C levels between these groups, therefore leading to a higher probability of a false negative or type 2 error. A similarly underpowered analysis for daily apple consumption and overall health could suffer from the same error. So, is there ever a good reason to perform a subgroup analysis? Subgroup analyses can be useful for generating hypotheses if unexpected associations are detected that investigators want to explore in future studies. Being able to reproduce a finding from a subgroup analysis in a prospective trial is an important confirmation of validity. But there are some important rules to avoid the bad apples. Subgroup analyses should be pre-specified in the study protocol and statistical analysis plan. Analyses should be restricted to a few clinically important questions, and results of all analyses should be reported, not simply those with positive results. If subgroup effects are expected, trials should be appropriately powered to detect them. So you want to plan a trial to see if an apple a day really leads to fewer primary care visits? I'll bite.